President Biden has issued a record number of executive orders in his first month in office, with far-reaching implications. The North Dakota House passed a bill to create a joint committee examining federal laws and executive orders. The bill aims to nullify federal orders within the state if they violate the U.S. Constitution. How would that work exactly? What powers do states actually have to counter the federal government? At the border, there are fears of a growing crisis after President Biden suspended deportations for 100 days, stopped border wall construction, and stopped the Remain in Mexico program. Today, we sit down with Daniel Horowitz, senior editor of TheBlaze and host of the Conservative Review podcast. He is also the author of the new book, Stolen Sovereignty. This is American Thought Leaders, and I'm Jekielek. As you may know, YouTube has demonetized our channel. To stay connected, please make sure to sign up to our mailing list in the description below so you never miss an episode. Daniel Horowitz, such a pleasure to have you on American Thought Leaders.
Great to be with you today. So much to talk about.
So, Daniel, you know, President Biden has issued a record number of executive orders in his first month of office, some of them basically within days of coming into office. And obviously, these have very far-reaching implications. And, you know, you've actually been writing about states thinking about how to actually approach this and asserting their own rights. The North Dakota House passed a bill to create this kind of joint committee that would look at executive orders and federal laws, basically with the idea of being able to nullify them if they violate the U.S. Constitution. That's pretty fascinating and not necessarily something that's kind of in the collective consciousness. I mean, how would this actually work? What kinds of powers do states have to enact these sorts of things?
Sure. I mean, what people need to understand is that there are three branches of government, both at the state level and at the federal level. And each branch of government has a requirement to only use its powers in concert with the Constitution. So contrary to popular notion, it's not just the courts that get to determine constitutionality. Every branch of government equally has to determine the right way to go with the Constitution, because otherwise you don't have co-equal branches. And the founders were very clear about this. Madison, even Hamilton, who wanted a strong federal government. And having three branches of government and then a federalist system where you have a federal government, but then 50 states eventually, and even local governments, that wasn't a bug, but a feature of the system, because they didn't want any one power running away. Now, as much as they thought the power would be equal, relatively equal, they did envision the legislature predominating, as Madison said in the Federalist Papers. Because, look, you know, they represent the people, and especially when you talk about state legislatures, these are people that are often elected every 2 years. They walk among the people. That is self-governance. That's representative democracy at its core. What we have seen here, you mentioned Biden's executive orders, and I think it is kind of incomplete to have this discussion beginning with Biden. We have to discuss the backdrop of the year we live in. As Justice Sam Alito noted, we have never gone through a period of time in American history, and that's not an exaggeration, where we have had executive power, governors, mayors, county executives, even before the president, projecting such a degree of power that affects every aspect of your life, down to the breath you take, literally your face, your ability to breathe air or to open a business or to go to school. And it's all being done without a legislative process, where not only do you elect legislators, but, you know, there's kind of a transparent process. You have committee hearings, you have a committee markup, you have a floor debate, people get to weigh in, they call their representatives, they meet with them. It's not winner take all. Usually you have amendments and compromise, and it's something you could work with. Okay, well, you really think masks work, but do they work everywhere under every circumstance? What about people with disabilities? Okay, you know, you want this to shut down, but do schools have to shut down? There's no data supporting the notion that kids are and school openings are vectors for spread at all. In fact, all the research is in the other direction. These are the type of things you would air out. You would have, you know, I speak of coronavirus just because it really has engendered and encompassed every aspect of our life. This is the type of thing that you would have committee hearings. You would get to hear both sides and you'd make a determination. Instead, we have nothing but an executive, be it a mayor, be it a governor, be it the president of the United States, gets up there and says, I'm holding a press conference and here's what we're doing. It doesn't matter whether it violates the Bill of Rights. It doesn't matter whether it violates statute. It doesn't matter for how long you're doing it. It could be for 10 months and counting, and now they're saying into 2022. Shut up. Mind your own business. We don't need a legislature. This should concern everyone. It doesn't matter what side of the spectrum you're on in terms of broad politics, in terms of the coronavirus response specifically, other issues. And we could talk about some of the specific executive orders, but this should bother everyone. This is something that both Republican and Democrat presidents have been ratcheting up. Each one ups the next by projecting more power through executive actions. And we're not talking about just, you know, taking statute and longstanding policies and just having orders to implement them, which is the executive power. We're talking about very controversial, novel ideas. Again, even if one believes in masks, to mandate indefinitely everyone has to wear a mask when traveling, all forms of travel, anyone over two, no questions asked, up until the point where you're either throwing up or an oxygen mask drops when a plane is going down. Those are the only exceptions. No OSHA, no ADA, no questions about proper PPE. You know, the notion that you could do that executively, I don't care where you are on the spectrum, that is absurd. And that's why I think it's so important for state legislatures to get back on the playing field and start to take back some of that power.
Well, and before I ask you about this, you know, specific bill in North Dakota, it's very interesting. There's also been, this has come up on a number of shows, there's been this sort of element also of legislatures or Congress basically deciding that they're not going to legislate. It's almost like kind of passing the buck up to the courts or to the administration. So it's kind of happening from both sides, isn't it?
Absolutely. This is a bipartisan issue. It's happening at a presidential level. It's happening at the state level. And I think this is really where we, the people, need to come together. I find it shocking how anyone, again, I don't care where you stand on politics or the virus, but the notion that we could be on 10 months and counting where governors could make decisions that affect our lives in the most intimate way ever without any oversight, any input, is just absurd. And I'm finding all these governors, now that the state legislatures are finally convening in January, February, March, into the spring, because remember, the virus started, unfortunately, they started doing this right when the legislatures left. And then a lot of times they conveniently said, well, we can't convene because we're scared of spreading the virus. So, hey, you governor, do what you want. I mean, that is just so dangerous from any perspective. Look, you know, you have this in both parties. I saw the West Virginia governor, Jim Justice. He said, look, what I'm doing is working. We don't need to stop. I don't like this with the legislature coming and trying to limit my powers. And mind you, the bill they were proposing was only to limit the emergency to 60 days. That's a long period of time. I mean, when you tell people your life, liberty, property is gone, this is what we must do. This is what we can do. No questions asked. Now, I think we all agree, you know, if there's a nuclear bomb coming, you might need some sort of emergency in place, 24 hours, 48, 72. But a little bit beyond that, it's like it's no longer emergent. It might be important, but it's not emergent. And at some point, hey, the legislature needs to convene. And I think it was atrocious, the fact that the governor said, I'm not calling the legislatures back in session. And now a lot of them are saying, hey, you can't do this without me. hey, it's unconstitutional for you to pass a concurrent resolution to end the emergency without my authority. Well, it was unconstitutional for them to continue this stuff for 10 months to shut down businesses without just compensation pursuant to the Fifth Amendment. I mean, this is very serious. And again, a lot of people went along with this last March. Okay, this is unique. Maybe we'll quarantine for 15 days, even though we've never quarantined all of humanity. You only quarantine people with symptoms. But the fact that you can go on for 10 months engenders a lot of questions. Well, either it's not what you're saying it is, or what you're doing is not working. By your own admission, you're saying it's still an emergency. So then if it's still an emergency, obviously the non-pharmaceutical interventions are not really changing the natural geographical and seasonal curves that we're seeing in every state, very similar, irrespective of what they do. And we need to start having discussions about the science, about the data, about the law. Again, I mean, this is something that any self-governing group of people, whether you're liberal or conservative, should agree to, that the legislatures need to get back on the playing field.
Daniel, so what is it exactly? Why is there this general trend, perhaps, you know, exacerbated in this specific scenario of coronavirus or CCP virus, as we call it here at the Epoch Times? Are they just people just don't want to take the responsibility? They want to pass it up to the governor? Or what is it that is preventing the legislatures from, I guess, effectively wanting to do their job?
Well, look, I mean, I think when it comes down to it, some of it's political and some of it is also mechanical. I think at a political level, the Democrats seem to enjoy power. And regardless of whether that is legitimately projected and implemented and utilized by the governor, if they agree with the policy, I think that their view is the means justify the ends. And that's unfortunate. I think in states where you have Republican governors doing the same, of which there are many, I mean, really, with the exception of the Florida and South Dakota governors, maybe a couple others, most Republican governors are doing the same to varying degrees. You know, the Republicans in the legislature don't want to upend that, and they kind of just want to go along with it. A lot of it is they're woefully unprepared. The executive branch has all the power. They have all the agencies, the health departments, and they bombard everyone with this data and science. And I think some of these legislators, they have very small staffs. In some states, they have zero staff. And they feel very intimidated to engage. Maybe some of them feel, there's something not right about this, but they just don't feel comfortable with all the experts in the executive branch. You know, I think the legislative branch, they don't have enough of a, you know, a research arm, a legal arm to fight back. And that's part of the problem. And then again, as you mentioned, some of it is cowardice. I mean, it's easier to virtue signal on social media. And I think social media has really destroyed legislative bodies because they're all looking for an audience rather than privately legislating. They're all looking to make a point on social media. And this is how we've gotten to a point where Congress or state legislatures are nothing but tools for just spending more money, bringing home the bacon, and virtue signaling. And then finally, the issue is bringing home the bacon. I think they get threatened that if you don't go along with the emergency, you won't get the money. So it's a funny situation because the federal government has unlimited funds. You know, that printing press, as we've seen, is just unlimited, whereas the states don't really have the ability. They don't have a Federal Reserve that could create a balance sheet of $5 trillion overnight. And they do have to have a balanced budget, so they feel like they're limited for cash, and they feel like they have to go along with the emergencies in order to get the funding.
Okay, so we're talking in very broad swaths here. So let's go to the North Dakota example. Now, of course, they are proposing a bill that will that could effectively limit some of the executive powers and federal law to some extent if it's deemed unconstitutional by the legislature. Now, I guess the first question is, how common is this sort of action? Is this itself a kind of emergency action being taken by this legislature? Is this legislature unusual compared to others?
Sure. So I think the message is getting out there to some in the legislature that, yeah, we need to get back on the playing field. And this is not okay. When you see a president like Biden implement that many executive orders, and we're not talking about small potatoes. We're talking about, again, saying making it a federal crime, but without a statute, to breathe. I mean, I think we've become desensitized. Even if you agree with that, that is a very earth-shattering thing to do at an executive level without the input of a legislature. And it really brushes up against a lot of questions of privacy and personal liberties. You know, obviously the transgender stuff that men have to be accepted into women's sports and college dorms and locker rooms if they so choose. These are very officious and meddlesome and consequential, life-changing, civilization-changing acts. These are not your typical boring, you know, check-the-box changes that some executives do upon assumption of power during that first month. So I think these states are alarmed. And the North Dakota legislature, some backbenchers pushed a bill. It's HB 1282. And they said, look, we're going to set up a committee of neutralization of federal laws. And we're going to examine if the federal government is doing stuff that really is unconstitutional. As the body closest to the people, we need to interpose between the people's liberties and federal encroachment. So they set up this committee that is comprised of, it's like a standing committee, like you have, you know, the Judiciary Committee, the Appropriations Committee. So they have this committee focused on federal actions. And they're saying, wait a minute, are we going to want to implement this at a local level? And our founders envisioned this. Jefferson and Madison certainly talked about it in the nullification debate. But, you know, even Hamilton discussed this in Federalist 33, that obviously we have the supremacy clause of the Constitution that the federal government does, you know, the federal laws are supreme. But as Hamilton said, deriving this from two words in Article 6 of the Constitution, it will not follow from this doctrine that acts of the large society, which are not pursuant to its constitutional powers, but which are invasions of the residuary authorities of the smaller societies, will become the supreme law of the land. These will be merely acts of usurpations and will deserve to be treated as such. You can't have a federal government just saying we're taking away life and liberty and states are like, hey, there's nothing we can do. No, that is why we have multiple units and branches of government. So each one is able to throw a white flag on the next one and say this is not OK. I mean, can the federal government really do this? Is this pursuant to statute? Now, you ask, is this new? Is this concept new? I would say with Republican states, it's pretty new. With Democrat states, they've been doing this the last 4 years with President Trump. Let me give you a good example. They did this with federal immigration law. And look, now, I know you want to talk about immigration a little bit. People have a lot of different opinions on what sort of immigration policies we should have, but nobody can or should disagree with the fact that it is the federal government that controls certainly illegal immigration, because, you know, in order to traverse a state boundary, you first have to come across the federal union, the national border. So, I mean, everyone agrees that is a federal policy. That is legitimately something that is the whole of the people. It's international. It you know, as we saw with Trump in Mexico and Central America, it required a lot of negotiations, and they even had some sort of treaties they signed together. This is really, the court said in the 1800s, the immigration power flows from foreign affairs. So certainly it is very federal in nature, and yet still, almost every Democrat state, and certainly Florida and California, not only did they prohibit enforcement of federal immigration laws, even as it related to sex offenders and murderers that had ICE detainers, MS-13 officials had ICE detainers on them, they actually made it a felony in the state of New York for state and local officials to cooperate and pass on information to federal authorities. So my point is, if Democrat states are able to block legitimate federal immigration laws on the books as it relates to foreign nationals, so certainly states have the right and indeed the responsibility to interpose when the federal executive branch is legislating wholesale by administrative fiat on issues that really infringe upon American liberties for American workers, American school children, and, you know, just travelers, people with disabilities that are forced to wear masks under all circumstances, violating OSHA and ADA mandates. Again, you know, what's good for the goose is good for the gander. And I think those Democrat states with the sanctuary movement they created are going to learn that that movement could be used for other issues.
Well, so that's super interesting. And I think I'd like to get back actually to the immigration issue in a moment. Let's jump back to this North Dakota law. So this is passed in the House now. So how does this actually work? Do they have this committee now? Can it start analyzing these executive orders? What is the process? And is it similar everywhere?
Sure. So, I mean, there's a couple of other bills I've seen in Oklahoma, South Dakota, Tennessee that have somewhat the same idea that, look, you know, there's a lot of funny stuff coming out of the federal government, and we really need to not reflexively go along with that. As far as North Dakota, Republicans have an 80-14 majority in the House, a 40-7 majority in the Senate. We're talking about almost 5-1 majorities there in the Senate. But with that said, a lot of Republicans were kind of scared to go along with it, so it only passed narrowly. It has to go to the Senate, and it does need the governor's signature. It's unclear whether they support it yet, so I don't think it's a shoo-in to pass. It's not law in North Dakota yet. It passed the first level. There's two more to go. Other states are looking at maybe empowering the attorney general to make a constitutional recommendation, and then based on his recommendation, then you'll have a joint session of the legislature where they pass a concurrent resolution, which basically means both the House and the Senate pass identical language, and then you don't need the governor's signature. And then the enforcement of that order, that federal executive order, is prohibited at that state, in that state, in the counties. So some give it to the attorney general or the governor. Some outsource it to the courts, which is kind of a bait and switch because that's really the current practice anyway. Personally, I am a big fan of the legislature doing it. Again, because they are elected most often. They walk among the people. And like I said, it's not just elections. I mean, you know, governors are elected. Even judges at a state level, most states have some form of either initial elections or retention ballots. But there's no transparent process like the legislative process, where you really have a committee process, hearings, floor debate. That's where people could weigh in. And I think that's really where, you know, if there's one thing I wish in this country right and left could shake hands on, okay, you might want A, I want B, but let's do this through the legislative process. Let's not make the most earth-shattering changes through the executive and the court system.
You know, I'm just thinking right now, you know, there's been multiple basically polls and sort of done and surveys talking about how basically the trust in politicians of Americans is quite low, right? So, you know, I'm taking what you're saying very seriously that, you know, the legislatures need to step up, but and that these people, especially in the state legislatures, walk among the people and so forth. However, we do have this situations where it's the situation where there's just a lot of people who just don't trust the politicians. So, I mean, I guess the question is for people who are wondering, you know, is it even worth doing anything? What can I do when the politicians don't even listen? How do I even get a group of interested people together? Will it make a difference? I mean, these are the types of questions that I think we're seeing, you know, all over the place when you look in social media, when you look in, you know, various articles and so forth. Tell me, what are your thoughts here?
So I kind of disagree a little bit. I think there's a lot people can do. You're right that there's a lot of apathy, that the politicians aren't listening because they're not doing anything. The people who are doing this stuff aren't listening because they don't need to listen. They're either unelected judges or health department officials stashed in some county, state, or HHS in Washington. And no one knows who they are, just creating these funny things that govern every aspect of our life. But if we actually got in the faces of the county commissioners, the school board officials, the sheriff, the state legislators, you'd be surprised what a group of 15 to 20 people together could do. We don't do it. We don't get on the playing field. So that's why they don't hear it. They just hear from the special interests. But you'd be surprised at a local level, if you get people that are vocal, they'll hear it. You call them, you demand to meet with them, you start publishing information. Hey, this guy just did a bait and switch on the House Judiciary Committee. Nobody follows that. I've been trying to write articles on that. It covers as many states as I can. It's hard. I started a new organization, Constitution Action Network. It's conaction.network, where people could sign up and give us their state, and we'll pair them together with a strike force team of 15 people, at least within a state, that will focus on, you know, this stuff we're talking about. A lot of legislatures now are talking about broadly limiting the emergency powers of the governors, but they do a bait and switch. So they'll say, yeah, you know, we'll limit it to 60 days, but the governor could extend it anyway, rather than the governor can extend it unless the legislature agrees to extend it. There's a lot of these games. Or, you know, in Kentucky, they passed a bill saying that, you know, schools and businesses should open pursuant to CDC guidelines. Well, that's the whole debate. It's the whole enchilada, which basically means they can't open in any sane way. So, again, this is what needs to happen. Kind of like a drill. What a drill focuses the pressure and the torque on a very narrow area, and that's when you can have your impact. You look at the country as a whole, and people just throw back their hands and say, "What could I do?" But you know, if you're in a legislature, if you have a legislative sessions going on right now, you'd be surprised at how few people focus on that process. Nowadays, there's a lot of websites where you could track these bills and see what they're doing. And if you see a good piece of legislation, be like, hey, why aren't we pushing that? Why isn't leadership you know, holding a vote on this to give legislative input at least after 30 days of a governor declaring emergency? These are certainly things that need to be discussed. You know, schooling. Are we going to mask our kids forever? I mean, that is, at this point, that is an important question to ask. What is your evidence behind that? We're seeing, no matter what, that schools do not contribute to the problem. We're seeing kids have less of a problem to this from this even than the flu, even for those that really are very bullish about, you know, lockdown policies for adults. For kids, the evidence certainly is not there. So, I mean, this is stuff that a lot of people could do. Now, as one person, it's tough. You get burnt out. But if you get 15 people together and you start maybe dividing it by county, this person deals with the sheriff at an implementation level, this person deals with some county commissions, this person deals with state legislatures, this person will write articles and go on radio, this person will call meetings. There's a lot that can be done. It's all part of self-governing. We need to make self-governing great again.
Well, yeah, and presumably, you know, you just described you have some resources for these people where they could, you know, kind of learn how to do some of this stuff. So that sounds really interesting. We'll put the link in below. Now, let's jump to this immigration question. You know, in 2019, there was, you know, basically by many standards, an immigration crisis. You know, there had been, I think, over a million people had basically come through, migrants had come through the border. The system was kind of overwhelmed. And so a series of policies were put in place by the Trump administration to kind of, you know, deal with that. Now, a number of these executive orders, going back to what we were talking about at the beginning, from the new Biden administration, have had directly to do with immigration and border security. And, you know, from what I understand, the numbers are back at something like 3,000 people, even more a day, which is kind of pushing in that direction of back in 2019. You know, a lot of people are wondering kind of what's going on here exactly. I guess the question is, there's been a lot of criticism of these executive orders related to immigration and border security. Where do you see the biggest problems?
I mean, President Biden is basically saying, I don't believe in immigration enforcement. And he said he's suspending deportations. Now, if you are, according to the INA, if you enter the country without documentations, you have to be placed into removal proceedings. That's the law. Now, someone might not like it, and I think they are concurrently introducing legislation to just maybe change those laws, but currently they are the law. And it's kind of bizarre. And they're not voodoo laws. I mean, every country has those laws. You are not a sovereign nation if you don't have a way of controlling who comes into your country. So the notion that a president could do that is extremely, extremely novel. It is very hard to imagine that. It's actually funny that when Alexander Hamilton, he wrote an essay on basically just explaining the difference between a king and a president, because many were concerned, if you, you know, study history, you know that we start off with a legislature. It was the Continental Congress, and there was just one branch. And when they created the Constitution, they created this presidency, and a lot of people are like, well, wait a minute, you know, we just got done with a king. I don't like what's going on here. So Hamilton wrote in the Federalist Papers, it was Federalist 70, he wrote an entire essay contrasting the power of a president to that of a king. And he wanted everyone to be clear that, look, this is a new office. He's the chief executive officer of the executive branch. He's there to execute the laws. He doesn't make law. He certainly can't violate rights. And he can't, you know, he can't just do whatever he wants. And one of the things he said, it was pretty amazing, is that he used the example of making denizens of aliens. It's pretty funny how, you know, of all things, he picked that as the paradigm of what a king can do. I'm sorry, it was Federalist 69. He said a president can confer no privileges, whatever. A king can make denizens of aliens. And, you know, again, you know, you need Congress if you want to give them de facto legal status. That is something you need the president. And then also, I mean, you know, you mentioned the border crisis. It is true. In parts of Texas, we are back up to levels that we didn't see since 2019. And one thing I found very funny that a lot of people forgot, what is the buzzword that we have heard throughout, you know, this whole COVID crisis, was that in order to alleviate the burden on hospitals, governments can infringe upon fundamental rights. I mean, stuff that everyone agrees, life, liberty, property, your business is shut, you're done. Okay, that's what, I'm not agreeing with it, but I'm just saying that is what we have said, basically as a nation, as a government, this is what we're doing. Americans don't have First, Fourth, Fifth, and 14th Amendment rights because we need to make sure that hospitals aren't overrun. What I found shocking is that the media did not cover this. But in 2019, we had our borders rushed with people coming over during flu season. They were coming to use the hospitals for elective surgeries. They had mumps. They had tuberculosis. They had chickenpox. And they were coming for all sorts of things. And these were, you have to realize that the border, most of them are like Yuma, you know, Eagle Pass, Texas, small cities that don't have large hospitals. They were overrun. Americans had to wait online. I mean, this is well documented. It was a healthcare crisis. CBP commissioner at the time, Mark Morgan, said this is not just a humanitarian crisis and a security crisis. It's a health crisis they had at the border. They had all sorts of field hospitals. Never once did we say illegal immigration, not legal, illegal immigration needs to be shut off so we don't have a run on the hospitals. So illegal aliens have greater rights than Americans. It is truly unbelievable. Now we have the pandemic. And according to their logic, I mean, this is Biden's logic, that human movement and gathering is the decisive determinant outcome in an epidemiological curve. That's his view. So the greatest way to spread is to have international mass influx, international travel, because remember, each country kind of has its own curve. But if you import from another country, that might be a little bit later, they get their, it's called the Hope-Simpson curve. The southern latitudes tend to get the winter spread that we seem to be over with. They get it in the spring, and we saw that last year around too. They could bring that in. No concern. COVID is they're not tested or nothing. I mean, they're sent on buses now. A lot of Haitians are coming in at the Texas border. They're bussed in, and that's it. They stop the turnarounds. They're, you know, turning them around, said, look, it's a pandemic. We can't go through the process. So your business is shut down. You must wear a mask for the rest of your lives. Your kids can't go to school. But foreign nationals have the right to crash our border. This violates the social compact at its core, a government of, by, and for the people, by the consent of the governed. That's in the Declaration of Independence. Again, this is not right or left. This is the purpose of government. We have an extremely generous immigration system, which, by the way, for the most part, we did not shut down during the pandemic while Americans are locked down. But the notion that you're going to have illegal immigrants crashing the border during the pandemic really is very revealing as to when they care about COVID and when they don't.
Well, so why don't you tell me, what do you think is actually going on here?
I think it's kind of the same reason why they were concerned about COVID until we had the George Floyd, you know, 10 of his funerals, or which were indoors, or all the mass rioting and protesting that was virtuous. You had doctors putting out letters saying that this is great. This is First Amendment in action. I mean, it's heads they win, tails conservatives lose. And I think that's what it is. It's whatever. It's all about power. Let's face it. If they knew that these people would be voting a different way, they would have landmines and machine guns at that border. If it were more like Eastern Europeans that tend to be a little bit more conservative because they've had bad experiences with communism, if they were coming over, I think we would see a different policy. And it's all, like I said, the means justify the ends. They want more voters. This is it. This is what we're doing. I got it straight confirmed from the State Department that refugee resettlement, they are not testing them for COVID. They're bringing them from all parts of the world. How is it that American school children are treated the way they are, but when it comes to the sacred thing of immigration? Or let's look at this from a labor standpoint. You know, for a while before COVID, we had virtual full employment. But, you know, below 4% unemployment is considered full employment. So, you know, maybe you could say maybe we need more foreign labor. But then we had the worst lockdown ever. And, you know, we have a lot of problems with jobs. A lot of people are out of work, particularly a lot of people might have some sort of job, but they're woefully underemployed and their hours were cut back. How could you justify bringing in more foreign workers? It just doesn't make any sense. A, the pandemic, just in terms of the viral spread, and B, just the labor market. But this is how so many Americans get the impression that the government just doesn't work for them. It's not about – it's putting Americans last. It's all whatever the big tech, the big corporations want. They want the cheap labor. You know, it's kind of the masters of the universe get together. This is really more than a right versus left. It's up versus down.
Well, you know, I think one of the big arguments that I understand is the case for basically facilitating, asylum, cases, immigration from, you know, Central America and so forth, is basically on, you know, compassionate grounds, right? And, you know, frankly, situations in a lot of these countries are a lot worse, and there's a lot of people that need help or are looking for help. And this is, I think this is the idea. This is what, you know, I think the people who are supporters of at least some of these policies would imagine. You know, America is a benevolent country and, you know, helps others.
Sure. So, wow, I mean, that, man, that's an hour discussion in and of itself. I'll give a couple of brief pointers on that. First off, again, starting with the pandemic, no country is doing this during a pandemic. If you are locking down in some states, they still have curfews. I mean, you have curfews on your own people. You're certainly not going to have international migration. I mean, that just doesn't add up. But broadly speaking, there's a lot of misnomers there. So first off, our entire immigration system is one big refugee and asylum. So they get multiple bites at the apple. We don't have a skills-based system. We need to create one. But we basically, our legal immigration system is primarily people from third world countries, impoverished countries. We have over a million a year. Then we have hundreds of thousands of guest workers. We have refugee, we have asylum, we have TPS, we have SJV, we have the UAC, we have U visas. I'm just going through a few. We have VAWA visas. We have all sorts of categories. So they have multiple bites at the apple, and then they look at each one and they say, we need more of this, and they forget the other ones. And then there's the definition of what is a refugee and what is an asylee. A refugee and asylum was meant for a very limited scope. It was, you had a particularized political group, ethnicity, or race, or nationality that were being persecuted by a majority, and you disentangle that minority from that majority, and you bring them in. It wasn't a third world in poverty. It's kind of a lousy place to live. We're bringing everyone in. Say what you want about Latin America, but it's a very homogenous place. We're not disentangling a persecuted minority from a majority. It's just a green light. Hey, anyone who you want is in. And the question is, how much? So again, we already have so much legal immigration from these countries. We've had two generations of illegal immigration, and we're going to continue this. So here's the question that people who support it need to ask themselves. If their belief is that anyone who pays a smuggling cartel, which, by the way, is killing Americans with the proceeds by killing our youth with drugs, the cartels and the smugglers and the caravans, if we have a moral obligation to let anyone who successfully does that into the country, then don't we have a moral obligation to land boats in those countries and prospectively bring them in? Why should someone who pays the cartels be better off than someone who doesn't? What about someone who's maybe disabled or old or can't make the trek? Shouldn't we have to bring in every human being from every impoverished country? I mean, I once worked out, if you look at Guatemala and Honduras's GDP, if you look at every country below that GDP level, we would have an obligation to bring in over 2 billion people, or, you know, 1.5 billion people to this country. It makes no sense. It literally makes no sense. That's never what it was designed to be. And also, we are harming these countries by draining off their people. They need to build their own countries. And we spend a tremendous amount of foreign aid on development. So this is, again, where they get two bites at the apple. They bring them in, so they're working against the aid, because the point of the aid is to build up those countries. You know, a lot of these governments, you know, some of the last regime in Guatemala actually worked with Trump to put an end to the caravans. They didn't like it. It was harming their country. It was ruining their ability to get off the ground. So it doesn't help anyone. You know, it's like fat and calories. You know, if I say, you know, I'm pro fat, I'm pro calories, it's good for you. Well, what a vacuous statement. I mean, how much? What type? What sort of quantity? Over what period of time? You know, some is vital. Some is kind of neutral. Beyond that, it's very harmful. And that's really what immigration policy is, as almost every policy is. It's not in the absolute. And we are coming off a period of record legal and illegal immigration from this past generation. And you have labor market issues. You have assimilation issues. You have cultural issues. You have criminal issues. Again, you know, when you have a wild border and people just pay cartels and come over, not everyone is like that, but you have an awful lot of bad guys coming over. Let me just give you some statistics. Just in fiscal year 2019 alone, those who are subject to detainers by ICE in FY 2019. So these are just the people ICE has identified with just the force of 6,000 deportation officers. Very small force. That's a third of the size of NYPD. They had a cumulative history of 1,923 murder charges, 56,000 assaults, 14,500 sex crimes, 5,000 robberies, 2,500 kidnaps, and 74,000 DUIs. DUIs is a particular problem we're seeing from the illegal immigrants from Latin America. There's a lot of studies that have been done on that. That is a simple fact. In New York City alone, the detainers that were lodged accounted for 200 homicides, 500 robberies, 1,000 sexual assaults. Let me say this. In a given year, New York only has about 300 to 350 homicides. Now, they weren't all necessarily within that one year, those 200, but you get what I'm saying. This is something you can't ignore. We have the problem with the gangs. And what we're doing is we're feeding this circuitous cycle of bringing, of basically telegraphing the message that anyone who comes here with a kid, you're here to stay. Now, let's say I say I'm for charity, and I'm going to go out on I-95, the busiest highway on the East Coast, and hand out bread on the interstate. Well, you can only begin to imagine the cascading effect of misery you're going to create with all the car crashes and everything. And it's a similar thing. When you create a market for smugglers and really bad people, and the gangs, we have this problem of rent-a-child, all these people that rent kids, kidnap kids as their ticket to get over. And then you have these 15, 17-year-old boys being dropped into the country without much support or sense of purpose or sense of identity to America. Guess what? They are prime recruits to MS-13. Any U.S. attorney, DEA agent, FBI agent that works this will tell you the last 5 years when we've had this Central American influx, MS-13 was almost killed off last decade. They're thriving now, and it's a circuitous cycle of drugs and violence and kidnappings. And and look, I could go on and on. I know you got to run. I'm going to leave you with one point. When you do immigration irresponsibly, too much from certain areas over too short period of a time in the wrong way, you get what is bad for Americans and bad for the immigrants. What you want for the immigrants is to experience America. You don't want to experience from where they came from. But what you do with these policies is you turn America into the countries from where they came from, where you don't have the rule of law, and you have anarchy like we're seeing at the border. And I've seen the Washington Post, actually, of all publications, did a good series on MS-13's growth in the area of the country where I live, around the Washington suburbs, both the Virginia and Maryland side, among the Salvadorian community. And what they've done is basically, they would have quotes from people that appear to be illegal immigrants themselves. And they said, this is exactly how it's like in my home country, where they would have to pay extortion in neighborhoods in Silver Spring, Maryland, Wheaton, Maryland, Prince George's County, Maryland, places in Arlington and Fairfax, Virginia, where you now have MS-13 that has recruited from these illegal alien children. And where you have these families that now are living and often have to pay extortion to MS-13 on our soil. You bring in the right amounts, in the right flow, in a controlled fashion, in a vetted way. You can enrich America and give immigrants the American experience. You do it the way we're doing it now, and you bring all of the problems that everyone clearly agrees exist in those countries. That's why they're saying, oh, we have to let them in. You bring them to the shores of America.
So, yeah, and to finish up, actually, we do have a situation, for example, where Texas is saying, hey, wait a sec, I don't know if we want to do all these things which are being mandated federally. And so, you know, to finish up, I'm wondering if you could kind of let us know what the status of that is, what a state like Texas can actually do. I believe this is through the governor, at least in part. You know, what's the expected outcome?
I mean, you're talking about the border,
yeah,
or other issues. So as far as the border is concerned, so yeah, I mean, there's we talk about states pushing back broadly, but then there's the border states. Look, Article 4, Section 4 of the United States Constitution guarantees states protection from an invasion. That is why they joined the Union. Justice Scalia used to say that states would have never joined the Union had they known that a president, he said this when Obama was doing something similar, could just nullify sovereignty law and saddle the states with the fiscal and security burden of illegal immigrants in their education system, their healthcare system. They would have never joined that. You know, the federal government was given control over immigration to protect states from influx because they didn't want other states kind of bringing in too many people that really weren't good for the Union, just so they could juice up their representation in Congress, their census numbers, which is literally what California does today. They didn't do it to abrogate state sovereignty. And at some point, if the federal government is derelict, they have a right and a responsibility. I know Texas DPS, Department of Public Safety, they have the Texas Rangers. There is a lot they could do. They do have a lot more assets, certainly, than other states do. And they've deployed them in the past. And they have a right to protect their state. Not a matter of setting up their own process or whatever, but turning people back. And again, if a governor could shut down your mouth, literally, your mouth cannot be open without a mask. Your business can't be open unless under these circumstances. Your private schools can't be open unless under these circumstances. If that's true, they certainly have the right to shut down illegal immigration.
Daniel Horowitz, any final thoughts?
Look, I mean, it's all local. It's all about making state legislatures great again, making self-governance great again. I think what's important to realize, look, it's no secret. You hear it in my voice. I'm a conservative. And people have different views. But I think what we should all agree upon is this. I would love for all 50 states to reflect my values and all cities to reflect where I want the country to be and where I think the Constitution really was supposed to take us. But from a pragmatic sense, I understand that we have a very divided country. The only way to disagree agreeably in a fashion that I think will avoid any violence and acrimony is to really start devolving this power, where the federal government, it's not winner take all, and you know, you get in power and you get to do whatever you want everywhere and control people's lives. We need to start devolving these decisions to local units of government where people could start self-sorting. And you know, if this area of the country reflects more your values, then, you know, that's where you're going to go. And I understand, let California be California, but let Texas and Florida and North Dakota be the way they are. And that way we could, you know, self-sort. And that's a good way to have competition, too. You get to see which ones are doing better, which states are thriving better. Who has good ideas, and you could copy them or learn from the mistakes of failures. This is what our founders envisioned, and I think this is the way we're going to have to operate as a country. We have to recognize that people do have different interests. We had this even from the founding of our country. The first challenge to the federal government's authority was the Whiskey Rebellion in 1794 when Alexander Hamilton instituted a tax on whiskey. And the truth be told, you know, there was no right answer. They needed revenue to pay off the Revolutionary War debt. But at the same time, they really stuck it to the Western farmers in Kentucky and Appalachia, Western Pennsylvania, and it really didn't affect the merchants on the coasts and, you know, Hamilton's allies. And they rebelled and they took up arms. And George Washington, you know, the federal government was new and it was very fragile, and he quelled that rebellion very swiftly. But at the same time, he understood where they were coming from, and he pardoned the leaders of the rebellion, because he understood, you know, it did disproportionately affect them. And, you know, when you say, I'm going to shut you down and I'm going to shut down your business, you have to wear a mask, you're a threat. Even if you buy into the science behind that, you do have to understand that is a earth-shattering step for a government to take. And we're going to have self-sorting. We're going to have areas, look, if you want to wear a mask, go wear it. You know, you want to stay in your house for the rest of your life, that's lovely. If you happen to have a job that allows you to do that, but a lot of people don't have the luxury of that. And you have to understand and respect that. I resent it no end when I see government workers earn their paycheck because they could have a government job where they could work online, and they earn their paycheck off shutting down another person's paycheck who can't work online. He has a restaurant. What's he supposed to do? So these wealthy executives or these government workers, that's lovely. You're not affected by it, but these people are. How do you judge them? And this is where we're going to have different strokes for different folks. We're going to have, you know, states that start reflecting the other side of the view, like the other side of the divide, like California and New York reflect the values of their side. The Republicans or a new party needs to reflect the other side. And I think that's going to be good for everyone. It's going to create choice and competition in the marketplace. You're already seeing people vote with their feet, moving out of places like New York and going to Florida. And this is what needs to happen. You cannot have a one-size-fits-all solution. Our founders understood that in a republic of 8 million people. That certainly rings true today in a country of 330 million people.
Well, Daniel Horowitz, such a pleasure to have you on.
Really appreciate it and looking forward to coming back.